It's Professor Dave. Let's talk about linear transformations.
He knows a lot about all kinds of stuff, Professor Dave explains.
We've already learned about vector spaces, so it's time to talk about linear transformations on vector spaces. These transformations can be thought of more or less as functions on vector spaces. Let's take a closer look now. Building on what we learned years ago in algebra, whereas a function f of x will take some value x and transform it into a new value, a linear transformation, L of v, will take the vectors in a vector space and transform them into new vectors. The biggest difference here is that the transformed vector will not always be the same kind of vector we started with. For example, we could start with v in the vector space of vectors of length 2, R2, and end up with a scalar. Or we could start with 2x2 matrices and end up with a vector of length 3, and so on. In this way, a linear transformation can be said to map one vector space V to another vector space W. This is denoted as L:V:W. The linear transformation will only take in vectors from the vector space V and will always give back vectors from the space W. For example, in mapping L, R2 to R, this will only take in vectors of length 2 and it will give back scalars. While linear transformations are flexible in mapping from one vector space to another, it is still possible to map back to the same vector space, which would be represented as L, V to V. There are two important properties for these transformations to qualify as linear. First, transforming the product of a vector V and a scalar C is the same as the product of the scalar and the transformation of the vector V. Second, the transformation of the sum of two vectors, V and W, is the same as the sum of the transformation of each vector. These are the requirements that must be satisfied in order to be a linear transformation. As an example of what a linear transformation might look like, consider the mapping L, R2 to R3, given as follows. L of V will take in vectors of length 2, V1, V2, and will give back vectors of length 3 given by V2, V1 plus V2, V1 minus V2. Let's go ahead and verify that this is a linear transformation. First, we will multiply the vector V by a scalar C, and see if the transformation of the product can be written as C L of V. Multiplying the vector V by C, our new vector becomes CV1 CV2. Once we transform this new vector, we get CV2, CV1 plus CV2, CV1 minus CV2. We can factor out the C from each element of the vector and then pull the scalar out of the vector to obtain C times V2, V1 plus V2, V1 minus V2. We already know that this vector is just the linear transformation of the vector V, so we can write this as C L of V. We have verified the first requirement. Next, we must check that the transformation of the sum of two vectors, V and W, can be written as the sum of the transformation of each individual vector. Letting V equal V1, V2, and W equal W1, W2, then the sum is simply V plus W equals V1 plus W1, V2 plus W2. When we stick this new vector into our transformation, we obtain V2 plus W2, V1 plus W1 plus V2 plus W2, V1 plus W1 minus V2 plus W2. Using the associative property of addition, we can rearrange this into V2 plus W2, V1 plus V2 plus W1 plus W2, V1 minus V2 plus W1 minus W2. We can then split this into the sum of two vectors, V2, V1 plus V2, V1 minus V2, plus W2, W1 plus W2, W1 minus W2. Each of these is simply the transformation of the vectors v and w, meaning we can write them as L of v plus L of w. We have now satisfied the second requirement and demonstrated that this is in fact a linear transformation. As we might recognize, the conditions for linearity can be thought of as relating to the commutativity of operations. The first requirement is essentially saying that the processes of scalar multiplication and applying the function commute. And the second requirement is saying that the processes of vector addition and applying the function commute. This is just like the commutativity of adding or multiplying numbers. The order shouldn't matter. A useful thing we can do with linear transformations that map Rn to Rm is representing them as a matrix. So a linear transformation of a vector, L of v, can be written as an m by n matrix A multiplied by v. In order to get this matrix, all we must do is transform the standard basis of Rn, and that will make up the columns of our matrix A. To see this in action, let's once again consider our linear transformation from R2 to R3. L of v equals v2, v1 plus v2, v1 minus v2. Since we start with vectors from R2, we want to transform the standard R2 basis vectors, 1, 0, and 0, 1. Transforming 1, 0, we get 0, 1 plus 0, 1 minus 0, equals 0, 1, 1. Transforming 0, 1, we get 1, 0 plus 1, 0 minus 1, equals 1, 1, negative 1. These two vectors will be the columns for our matrix, giving us 0, 1, 1, 1, 1, negative 1. We can verify that multiplying our vector v by this matrix will give us our linear transformation. A times v gives us 0, 1, 1, 1, 1, negative 1, times v1, v2. Going through the matrix multiplication, we get 0 times v1 plus 1 times v2, 1 times v1 plus 1 times v2, 1 times v1 minus 1 times v2. Simplifying, we get v2, v1 plus v2, v1 minus v2, which is exactly the form of the linear transformation we started with. There are many practical applications of linear transformations, such as stretching and squishing coordinate systems, reflecting and rotating them, as well as shifting them. But now that we've laid down the basics, let's check comprehension. Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.